life is a participation sport. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got to get off the bench and put something into it. If you, you know, if you don't participate, and I know a lot of people who don't, then the most you're going to get is politics as usual. And if you participate, maybe you can change that. And do you think that politics changed you?
Well, I think it taught me a lot about negotiating and dealing with other people. But it was, you know, it's not for the faint of heart, okay? It's a bruising job all the time.
Would you do it again?
Yes, I'm happy I did it. And I you know, I have this...
No, I mean, again, like in a couple of years.
Oh, I don't know. Okay. I'm very strongly drawn to public service. But, you know, you can be in public service if you are in the Rotary.
Right.
Or if you're doing emergency services or you're a volunteer firefighter or any of those things.
Right.
And you can do public service and serve your community and raise money to help people who need it and all those things without being elected.
Right.
And so if, you know, I was always in it to get stuff done. There are ways to get stuff done in politics and there are ways to get stuff done outside politics. And so while I'm strongly drawn to public service, I really like solving problems, making people happy, getting my community to do the right thing and be the right place to be. I don't know that I have to be in politics to do that.
I mean, with the way things are now, in some ways, politics could be limiting. You know, with the skills you have from politics, outside of politics, you might be able to get a lot done because there are limits. There are limits.
And it's a team sport.
Yeah.
And my team happens to be Republican, but it's still a team sport if you're a Democrat. So you're not free to say what you think and believe depending on where your political party is.
Right.
And so it's liberating to be free of that.
What's something now? You're just Kate Harper on the radio. What's something that you'd want to say now that you couldn't have said before?
That's a good question. I think it would be a good thing to say that there are some limitations that you can put on guns that should be and are, in my view, and I'm a lawyer, constitutional and would be good and not hurt anybody who's a lawful gun owner. I'll give you an example. I voted for a bill that if you're found that you have, you know, abused your spouse and they get a protection from abuse order against you, that protection from abuse order can also say that you have to turn your guns over to a law enforcement officer or somebody or a gun dealer to hold while the order is in effect.
Mm-hmm.
Because anybody will tell you, you got a better chance of getting killed by your spouse than anybody else.
Yeah.
Or significant other. I mean, seriously.
Yeah.
You do. So if your spouse is already beating you up, it just makes sense to remove the gun, you know, and I was roundly criticized for that. Because I'm a Republican, don't I know what the Second Amendment means? Look, I know. I not only understand the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms, which I believe in.
Right.
You know, but there are even limits on the First Amendment right of free speech. Famously, you can't yell fire in a crowded theater. So every now and then, there can be limits on gun ownership that are the right thing to do.
Right.
After due process and after, you know, due consideration. I'm all in favor of due process, you know, getting a hearing and all that. But I do think that if you're against any limitations on any constitutional right, that's not really
yeah.
a nuanced view.
And that's not how change happens. And some things have to be adapted because technology and everything changes. And it's the thing you said with the PFAs. And the gun ownership, that just seems like a no-brainer because it just makes it so easy for something to go wrong. And one of the things that bothers me in that arena is that somebody can have a PFA against them and go get a gun. And it just seems right. like there should be some kind of stopgap where you have to go through some bit of extra thing when you're in the midst of a stressful thing that you're buying this, you know, if only to say, well, why now? You know, because it just facilitates. I was raised where guns were tools. They were farm tools for taking care of varmints and safety and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a different thing. It was never a toy. It was a tool. You don't take a chainsaw to school to play with it. You know, it was the same thing.
No, but my father-in-law used to take my boys out to the shooting range to target shoot.
Yeah. Well, we used to shoot on the farm. You know, you'd be 13 years old and shooting and you didn't have to do anything. But we knew it wasn't a toy. We knew it was something you respected.
You respected, right. Because you learned how to handle it and respect it.
And I think there's just a casualness with it that goes, I'd say, and I think that there needs to be an educational component with it, because I think it is a right, it is also a responsibility, and I think there needs to be education. If you want to drive a super big car, you have to have a different class of license. You know, if you want to
drive a truck,
you have to have
a
different
CDL,
class,
because right.
different skill set, and I think that the skill set between a single shot musket is different than the skill set between some of these other weapons. You know?
But to get back to politics today, just for saying that, you would be labeled as, if you're a Republican, a rhino or a
right.
liberal even.
Right.
Because you even said there could be limits. And that's what's so upsetting, because you can't. And then the other side looks at you like you're crazy if you won't even agree to something that is reasonable. They do want to get rid of guns generally, and they right. want, you know, and that's kind of crazy.
That's crazy too. That's crazy. Absolutely crazy.
But if there's no nuance, if you're with us or against us, if you're one of them or one of us, then you never get to talk about things the way you and I are talking about them right now.
And that's the huge loss of the whole system, the way it is, that you can't talk about it, where you can't have a discussion. No one agrees to disagree anymore.
Right.
And I have better conversations when I disagree with the person, because that's how I learn. And that's how I shore up my own arguments. And when you get me to a point where I have to go, maybe you've got a better argument than I have. Maybe I have to rethink my thinking. And I like that. You know, I like that.
And at least you're willing to rethink your thinking.
Right.
You know, and, not everybody is.
And that's really a huge limitation on politics, because you're kind of towing the party line. And I don't think everybody on either side agrees with 100% of their party line. And they're, you know, you in effect become a politician. You give up a huge chunk of your freedom to defend other people's.
Right. Right. Now, I, for example, I would always try to follow Ronald Reagan's 11th commandment, never speak ill of a fellow Republican.
Right.
But sometimes they deserve to be spoken ill of. That's a problem, you know?
Yeah. There's no 100% saints or sinners in any group, you know? And one of the problems I have with all groups, and not just politics, is that how does the group police its own? You know, do you see no problem ever with anybody because they do the same thing as you? And I think if a group is that rigid on that, then something's wrong.
Well, let's look at the Democratic caucus in Congress these days, because it used to be that your elders or seniors could police you. Okay. You know, if Nancy Pelosi tells the newest congresswoman, look, stop talking about impeachment, it's not getting us anywhere. It used to be the youngest congresswoman would shut up about that, you know, because the Speaker of the House, you know, if she's right, you know, she's got some sway and some ability to affect your future. And now everybody, and now I'm talking about the Democrats, because it's interesting for me to see, but they're running all over the place and they're not listening to their elders either.
No, I want to be rock stars, you know, I want to be rock stars. And it's there's no... You know, another one of my pet peeves is that the older generation has to be a little more receptive towards the new generation. And the new generation has to seek out and maybe push a little bit, because we don't do mentoring anymore. You need to be mentored. It's an important part of development. And that's, you don't have mentoring. That's why you have all these freelancers out there running wild.
Right.
You know, because it was, you know. You know, you remember when you started and there was somebody that reined you in, you know, and
gave you advice and told you what to do. And speaking of that, Speaker of the House at the time when I first got elected was Matt Ryan from Delaware County. And he told me, don't give up your law practice. No matter what happens to you in politics, you can still feed your family.
Yeah.
And you know what? He was right.
Yeah. Yeah. And I remember, you know, when I heard it, you had lost, and I try not to get politics and sports in this area are just too emotional for me. I have other stuff to worry about, and they're just too emotional. I watch families fight over it. But I remember when I saw that you had lost, that bothered me because I felt like you were just a good person that wanted to serve the public. And it just seemed like that you didn't lose because of anything you did or didn't do. You lost because of a wave, you know, that was not your fault. And I just think that it's part of people not realizing the ramifications of different change. And I'm sure that does the person that won, do you talk to them? Have you reached
out? I met with her after she won. I helped her get the lease to my office. I tried to help her out, you know, to do that. I mean, it's in my interest as a citizen in the 61st to make sure that Liz Hanbidge does a good job. You know, I want her to represent my community well. That matters to me. I would say though that, you know, she's got to make her own way in the world. She's got to do her own thing and see if she can, you know, work it out. It was a wave election. And there were also people who told me, quite frankly, they were voting to send a message to President Trump. And I said, I don't think he even knows where Lower Gwynedd is.
Right, right.
Okay?
Right.
I don't think he's getting the message.
Yeah.
And they said, well, you have to start somewhere. And I said, no. And I hope that the people don't make the same mistake this year in those local elections because it matters. Those people who run your park and rec programs, those people who run who help your volunteer firefighters and run your local police, those people are running this year and it matters. And, you know, I don't think President Trump will notice if somebody in West Norton loses an election.
No.
But the people may notice it if that voice is not there who's been carefully stewarding, you know, whatever it is that needs to be done in West Norton Township. You know,
well, that's why it just,
and there is somebody there or somebodies who are doing those things.
It really, you know, just needs to be the best person for the job. And that's
right.
Why I hate it, you know, no matter what they are, male, female, you know, black, white, Republican, Democrat, needs to be the best person for the job.
Right. And I agree with that. And even though I'm a woman, people say to me, don't you think it's time for a woman president? I said, yeah, if we get the right woman.
Right.
But I don't think it's the right time for any woman to be president any more than I think it's the right time for any particular race or demographic characteristic. You pick the right person for the right job.
Right.
And,
yeah.
And if the parties would nominate the right people for the right job, it'd be easier for the voters to do that.
do a lot of politicians do what you do and help the person that after the election? I mean, or is that rare?
I think it's rare. I because it's so painful to lose. I tell people that the morning after the election, I wake up and I say, puh, just wasted 18 years of my life. And I think I went through the four stages of death and dying before I got out of bed, you know, denial and misery and, you know, euphoria, all before I get out of bed the next day. So, I mean, I think it's very hard to lose an election. And it makes most people pretty depressed, as I've seen.
But you took the high road. I mean, you didn't go in there with a screw gun and take the screws out of her chair. So when she leaned back, she flipped over backwards.
or the W off the keyboards, yeah. Right? Yeah. No, I didn't do that. I tried to do it right. And I do think, you know, I'm grateful that I had the chance to serve for 18 years. It was a great run, as you pointed out. And I got a lot done and I enjoyed it.
Let's do a little bit of after show. We killed the half hour real quick.
So okay.
I told you to go easy and we'll do a little bit of after show. But thank you, Kate. Thank you for your service and thank you for your continued dedication to your community. I need more people like that. Yeah. I don't know. I might have taken the screws out of the chair. I don't know. We're back with Kate Harper. We're going to do a little bit of after show, and she was saying how good the music is. When I picked the music for this, it was right at the beginning, and I never